Vril and the Alien Women. It started in England, back in 1589. A bright, young man of 19 years, William Lee, was in love with a girl who was preoccupied with knitting socks. Socks were an important item of clothing in the 16th century, and knitting them by hand was a slow but necessary process. When he was just 16, Lee was a prodigy who attended college at Cambridge on a full scholarship. He was a discoverer waiting to happen. 2 years after graduation, Lee was an official of his hometown when he met his love. He had not yet taken up his destiny and redirected history. But that would soon change. Frustrated libido is a powerful motivator. Lee applied his intellect. He designed and built a machine that imitated his lover's hand movements, producing the world's first sack machine. This way, he could both impress her and liberate her. When Lee presented his sack machine to Queen Elizabeth I, requesting a patent, she refused. She saw the potential for social disruption and expressed her concern for the country's hand knitters. She also perhaps foresaw a frightening premonition of what a mechanized world would be like. Lee eventually moved his machines to France with only limited success. He died in poverty, much like Nikola Tesla. And like Tesla, his invention did eventually change history. After Lee's death, his brother James returned to England and started the first mechanized factories producing socks made from wool, cotton and silk. This was the time thread that began the Industrial Revolution. Unrest and gloom covered the land. 16th century life was simple but harsh. Most people were farmers, most likely working the fields of some elite. The average life expectancy was 35 years, and half the population lived on the very edge of survival. The appearance of factories, urbanization and cheaply produced goods was an improvement for most people. But it didn't last. The move from hand power to the steam engine changed urban areas to a filthy environment with a stench. Individuals worked long shifts doing repetitive tasks, in unhealthy conditions. Although their life expectancy nearly doubled and material produced in the factories was abundant, people were not happy. Periodic plagues and disease took their toll on the new centralized culture. At the height of discontent, anti-machine and workers' riots erupted in many countries as the consequences of an industrialized society were realized. Although most groups moaned about the direction that our civilization had chosen, some groups became more proactive. Karl Marx, 1840, introduced the idea of common ownership, Marxism, where the workers were empowered as participants in the state. The profit motive of the factory owner was replaced with new raison d'etre for the good of the people. This revolution against the miserable lifestyle and disparity of wealth eventually won acceptance as communism replaced the elite czar in Russia and was creeping west across Europe. The Germans suffered these same misgivings with the Industrial Revolution, but they chose a different solution. Rather than endure the nationalization of Germany's industry through a communist government, the National Socialists, National Socialism, designed a solution where privately owned industry would play a major role. Germany would reinvent itself, rise like the phoenix, and citizens would serve the state with pride. Modeled after the Greek city-state of Sparta, the ideology captured the support of the industrialists and anti-communists. As it is true today, social stress sometimes leads people to become interested in religion or the occult as a means of escape. There was a fascination in pre-World War II Germany with archaeological reports about ancient Sumeria, the Ark of the Covenant, Odin, and Votan, Astarte, etc. People wanted to feel a connection to a time when Germany was stronger and prouder. There was great interest in knowing about our spirit life and learning how they could get back on the path to utopia. Helena Blavatsky's Theosophical Society and the Thule Society were the most influential occult groups. At some point, the public became fixated on an old book called The Coming Race. It was written in 1871 by Anonymous, but many believe the author to be Edward Bulwer Lytton. Originally considered as science fiction, many later readers believe that its account of a superior subterranean master race and the energy form called Vril was real and accurate. Many theosophists accepted the book as truth. Then something really strange happened. contact with extraterrestrials. It was December of 1919. The head of the Thule Society, Karl Haushofer, had invited a handful of the most respected occultists to meet at a secluded cabin in the forest foothills of the Alps, near Berchtesgaden. The guests included a representative of the Knights Templar and a specialist in Asian artifacts. As they gathered together, Haushofer revealed a surprise. Two young and exceptionally beautiful women joined the group. One of the young women was very quiet. She was barely 18 years old and, for some reason, her real identity was a guarded secret. She was introduced as Sigrun. Her significance will reveal itself later. The other woman was Maria Orzik, right? Aside from their stunning appearance, both had exceptionally long hair, contrary to the current vogue, that was worn in a ponytail. Haushofer introduced them as trans mediums and announced that Maria had received a communication from an extraterrestrial civilization. Some of the communication was in the form of text, automatic writing, written by Maria in her altered state. She showed the group several pages with strange symbols. Haushofer had the pages long enough before the meeting to have shown them around. He had determined that one was written in a secret Templar code while the other was in a Sumerian alphabet. Both had already been translated. The texts made some shocking claims, but offered proof of their validity, instructions on how to build an anti-gravity engine. Leaving no stone unturned, Haushofer even had the distinguished scientist, Victor Schaberger, review the physics of the design and literally sign off on its potential. Maria explained that the civilization she contacted originated in the constellation Taurus, the Bull. In particular, they were from a planet that was in orbit around a star called Aldebaran. The engine works on an energy source that is called Vril. Claims were made that the anti-gravity engine also has the ability to alter time. The texts are detailed enough so that the engine could be built, tested, and then used to transport worthy humans to their world for a meeting. While the Thule Society was focused on mediumship and contact with the other, their main interest was in finding an alternative to the inhumane and unhealthy industrial revolution that affected the German population. The anti-gravity engine was, according to Maria, a gift from this advanced race for humanity so that energy would be plentiful and wars would be unnecessary. But the Thule Society wanted the engine for its time travel potential. They dreamed of going back to the time when the gods walked the earth so they could learn more about spiritual truth. The guests believed what Maria had revealed. They agreed to seek financial support to build the engine from wealthy industrialists who were members of the Thule Society and other occult groups. Maria was quickly tasked with convincing contributors to help with this project. The Vril engine is built. Although they had the same objective, building the Vril engine, the Thule and Vril societies had different motives. The Thule Society was practical and foresaw a new energy source to exploit. The Vril were more concerned with making contact, learning from and potentially visiting the aliens on their world. In 1922, Thule and Vril jointly produced the JFM, Jensius Flugmaskine, or Otherworld Flight Machine. It was just the engine and was bench-tested on a tether for 2 years. It was during this time that the anti-gravity and time distortion were noted. Without notice, the JFM was abruptly taken apart and shipped off to the Augsburg works of Messerschmitt for future use. The project had been led by Dr. W. O. Schumann, Technical University of Munich, who later developed a levitation unit from the research, which was called the Schumann Munich or SM Levitator. Dr. Schumann had an unusual view of science and technology, believing in two opposing principles, explosion, the work of Satan, and implosion, the divine principle. This idea was also held by the Templars, supposedly the secret knowledge discovered by Pythagoras. In everything we recognize two principles that determine the events, light and darkness, good and evil, creation and destruction, as in electricity we know plus and minus. It is always, either, or. These two principles, the creative and the destructive, also determine our technical means. Everything destructive is of satanic origin, everything creative is divine. Every technology based upon explosion or combustion has thus to be called satanic. The coming new age will be an age of a new, positive, divine technology. Dr. Schumann, from SS Archives. The Vril engine did not consume, explode or destroy anything in its operation. It fit perfectly with the Thule philosophy and motivated Vril researchers' participation in this divine principle.
The Thule society has been underestimated and virtually censored from our history books. Seemingly crazy laws outlaw the display or discussion of these societies in Europe today. But it is a fact that Thule was largely responsible for creating the Nazi Party, so much so that their occult symbols are synonymous with the Third Reich. The swastika, lightning bolts of the SS and the Iron Cross, symbol of the Black Sun are but a few symbols with occult origins. As Thule became more concerned with politics and power, the Vril maintained their esoteric quests. All of the Nazi leaders were members of Thule and later, after Maria Orczyk's revelation, joined Vril. Adolf Hitler, Alfred Rosenberg, Heinrich Himmler, Hermann Göring, and Hitler's personal physician, Dr. Theodor Moral. All of the inner circle were Vril and Thule members. The success of the JFM was wisely kept secret until 1933, when one of their own became the head of Germany. Hitler is said to have given the go to both Thule and Vril developing their own Gesellschafts. He understood that the technology was a potential weapon. The Vril supervised development of the RFZ, Rundflugzeug, or round aircraft series in 1937 next to the Aerodo-Brandenburg aircraft facility. A series of RFZ discs were tested there, culminating in the RFZ-7. Meanwhile, Thule was working with a special SS unit, E4, exploring how to exploit this apparently new energy. They had their own disc project in a secret location called Honeberg, and it was not tethered. Beginning in 1935 their disc, above, was known as the H-DRAT, Honeberg device, eventually shortened to Honabu. In 1939 the disc's strebework, thrustwork, engine was perfected. Honabu 1 codenamed RFZ-5 when Thule moved it to the main testing facility in Aerodo-Brandenburg. The Thule strebework had an electromagnetic gravitic engine whose heart was a spinning tank of heated mercury and three parallel disks, rotating in opposite directions. Being a conductor, the mercury was made to interact with an electric field in such a way that it behaved like a superconductor and was able to isolate the immediate environment from local gravity effects. Some recent thoughts have compared the anti-gravity observations of monoatomic gold to what might be happening to the heated mercury. It has been noted that atoms not involved with cohesive bonds with other atoms, solitary atoms, gain back the energy usually expended in the bond and speed up and distort the orbits of their nuclear particles. These distortions somehow liberate the atoms from the effects of gravity. The anti-gravity engine only isolated the craft from gravity. It did not really levitate it. Although the energy needed was greatly reduced because of the elimination of gravity, the disc craft still required some power to ascend and move through the atmosphere. Some versions of the disc had jet engines and reached 2,900 to 12,000 km per hour. The Thule group eventually designed magnetic pulse thrusters that served to maneuver and propel the craft once they were in their anti-gravity state. As these magnetic thrusters had no explosion, they were the ideal solution. By 1944, Thule had produced the Honabu I-3 series, including some really large discs that were capable of carrying 200 troops, like the huge 139-meter-long cylindrical mothership called the Andromeda Drat. Andromeda device. The triumph of the Vril group was their seventh vehicle, Vril 7, designed specifically for interplanetary travel. As the war turned in favor of the Allies, Thule moved their production facilities to a deep mine in Poland. They continued work on their discs with slave labor until the very end, at which time the mine was flooded and collapsed to prevent Allies from gaining access. It's believed that any discs that were at this facility were flown away, but some think at least one or two were captured. The site shows the foundation of a large electric generator with conduits leading to the center of a large concrete platform, still there today, right? Vril also made plans to evacuate, but their plans were a bit more elaborate. They had their best interplanetary disk, Vril 7, ready to take them to safety in a most unlikely place. Over the years since Maria Orsic had made contact, the Vril had learned much about their telepathic, alien counterparts. In fact, the Vril's information about the aliens had already transformed the war effort with submarines and supply boats diverting resources to, of all places, Antarctica. Aldebaran civilization, been there, done that. According to the Vril mediums, the race of people they had telepathically contacted were from one of two inhabited planets that orbited an old star, called Aldebaran, 68 light-years away in the constellation we know of as Taurus, the Bull. On historical artifacts, they are always depicted with horns, right? They made contact because they had been observing human activity, specifically noting our warlike behavior. They decided to give humanity a gift, the Vril engine, to eliminate the competition for resources and energy, the cause of human conflict. Millions of years ago, the Aldebaran people had evolved to utilize Vril energy, akin to our understanding of electricity, but taken to an extreme. They had developed mental abilities such that they were able to interact with this Vril energy, using it for creative or destructive purposes. In the course of their sun's life, it had expanded to become a red giant. The environmental conditions on the inhabited planets caused biological stress and some of their race degenerated to where they lost their mental abilities to use Vril. When they realized this, they quickly isolated the pure Aldebaran race from those that degenerated and became strict about breeding and associating with the inferior strains. As the environment of their solar system deteriorated, the elite Aldebarans evacuated their race, both pure lines and inferiors, to other inhabited worlds. Earth was one of these. Although these thins were reported at the turn of the last century, well before Zechariah Sitchin made the Sumerian legends popular, it is easy to see that this same story is contained in the ancient Sumerian legends. Like Sitchin's theory, the Aldebarans noted the destructive effects of a dark sun that enters our solar system every 3,600 years and noted that, upon one cycle, the Earth became uninhabitable. The Aldebaran race retreated from the surface to a subterranean cavity located under the continent of Antarctica, from where they have been observing and attempting to control human destiny. The Aldebarans realized that this was too strange for anyone to believe, but they pointed to the many abandoned megalithic sites around the globe as evidence of their past life on the surface. In any event, they were offering 100% proof with the plans for the Vril engine. Once that was built and tested, the world would never be the same. Deutschland. We have a problem. It became evident to the Aldebarans, as well as the Vril, that the gift had been used unwisely. Production of disks with gun turrets and remotely operated weapon disks contradicted the original motive. The Vril visited the Aldebaran residents under Antarctica, as has been well documented, and began a program for populating a subterranean island called New Swabia. During the later years of World War II, it was noted that the SS had implemented special breeding programs, similar to those of the Aldebaran race, with the offspring destined to occupy this Antarctic land. While we cannot know whether these facts about Aldebaran were real or imagined, the construction plans that the Vril telepaths received were so accurate that they led to the successful construction of the Genseitz Flugmaschine, a flying machine for the other side. Eyewitness reports of Vril. In the 1957 case, agents at Detroit recorded that they had spoken with a man who was born February 19, 1926, in the state of Warsaw, Poland, and was brought from Poland as a prisoner of war to Gott-Alt-Galsen approximately 30 miles east of Berlin, Germany, in May 1942, where he remained until a few weeks after the end of World War II. An SS guard appeared and talked briefly with the German driver of the tractor, who waited 5 to 10 minutes, after which the noise stopped and the tractor engine was started normally. Approximately 3 hours later, in the same swamp area, but away from the road where the work crew was cutting hay, he surreptitiously, because of the German in charge of the crew and SS guards in the otherwise deserted area, observed a circular enclosure approximately 100 to 150 yards in diameter protected from viewers by a tarpaulin-type wall approximately 50 feet high, from which a vehicle was observed to slowly rise vertically to a height sufficient to clear the wall and then to move slowly horizontally a short distance out of his view, which was obstructed by trees. This vehicle, observed from approximately 500 feet, was described as circular in shape, 75 to 100 yards in diameter, and about 14 feet high, consisting of dark gray stationary top and bottom sections, 5 to 6 feet high. The approximate 3-foot middle section appeared to be a rapidly moving component producing a continuous blur similar to an airplane propeller, but extending the circumference of the vehicle so far as could be observed. The noise emanating from the vehicle was similar but of somewhat lower pitch than the noise previously heard. The engine of the tractor again stalled on this occasion and no effort was made by the German driver to start the engine until the noise stopped, after which the engine started normally. And then there is this. On April 26, 1967, the witness appeared at the Miami office and furnished the following information relating to an object, presently referred to as an unidentified flying object, he allegedly photographed during November, 1944. Sometime during 1943, he graduated from the German Air Academy and was assigned as a member of the Luftwaffe on the Russian front. Near the end of 1944, he was released from this duty and was assigned as a test pilot to a top-secret project in the Black Forest of Austria. During this period he observed the aircraft described above. It was saucer-shaped, about 21 feet in diameter, radio-controlled, and mounted several jet engines around the exterior portion of the craft. He further described the exterior portion as revolving around the dome in the center, which remained stationary. It was his responsibility to photograph the object while in flight. He asserted he was able to retain a negative of a photograph he made at 7,000 meters, 20,000 feet. According to him, the above aircraft was designed and engineered by a German engineer whose present whereabouts is unknown to him. He also assumed the secrets pertaining to this aircraft were captured by Allied forces. He said this type of aircraft was responsible for the downing of at least one American B-26 airplane. He has become increasingly concerned because of the unconfirmed reports concerning a similar object and denials the United States has such an aircraft. He feels such a weapon would be beneficial in Vietnam and would prevent the further loss of American lives, which was his paramount purpose in contacting the Federal Bureau of Investigation. During the war, especially the latter part, German U-boats made frequent trips to the South Atlantic, South America, and Antarctica. Germany also set up floating meteorological buoys in Antarctic waters and weather stations on islands located between Antarctica and the tip of South America. The SS RUSHA, RAS und Siedlungshaupt AMT Race and Settlement Bureau, began in 1942 to take women of Aryan descent, Vox Dutch, from the Ukraine solely for the purpose of transporting them to Base 211. 10,000 women between the ages of 17-24, blonde and well-proportioned, were recruited for the project along with 2,500 Waffen-SS soldiers serving in Russia. The goal of this massive undertaking was to create a colony at Base 211 suitable for habitation and continued development of the Thule Vril technology. It is believed that both the Thule and Vril Gesellschafts evacuated that technology to Base 211 at the close of the war under SS General Kammler, who was in charge of Germany's most secret weapons programs. Two U-boats that surrendered after the war in Argentina are also believed to have carried cargo and high-ranking SS to Base 211. Both boats were empty upon surrender, with the crews refusing to disclose their cargoes and destinations. In 1947, the U.S. Navy under Admiral Byrd conducted Operation High Jump. The expedition to Antarctica involved 4,000 naval personnel and 13 huge ships, including several large airplanes and helicopters. The goal was to map and catalog all of the coastline of the continent, including minerals and wildlife. The entire expedition was to last 6 months. During the expedition, a base was established at Little America, a coastal bay, and a tent city was constructed where aircraft could be maintained for the survey. Several teams of explorers were sent out to various corners of Antarctica with large format cameras for the photographic survey. When the crew photographing the region directly southwest of the Australian continent arrived for their mission, they were shocked. They radioed back that the coastal region was free of ice and that the water was 38°F. They continued to take photographs and later returned to process the images. Immediately after this event, the entire expedition was halted and all ships and naval personnel were made to return to the States. The results of the mission are still classified, after 60 years. Only Admiral Byrd, who was interviewed by a Chilean journalist on his trip home from the expedition, commented on the sudden return home. He stated that there was a danger which this expedition had encountered that posed a threat to every nation in the free world. He declined to elaborate on this.
As the reality of the war became clear, members of Vril were increasingly frustrated by attempts to use their revealed technology for killing machines. Around Christmas time 1943, an important meeting of the Vril Gesellschaft took place at the seaside resort of Kolberg. Maria Ortig and Sigrun presided and discussed the urgency of the Aldebaran project. They feared that the war chaos posed a danger to their ultimate goal of using the Vril engine's time warp potential to reach their benefactors on their Aldebaran planet. The mediums had received precise information about the habitable planets around the sun Aldebaran and had already planned a trip there. A few weeks later, at a January 22, 1944 meeting between Hitler, Himmler, Kunkel, of the Vril Society, and Dr. Schumann, the Aldebaran project was discussed. When tethered, the anti-gravity engine produced a time warp field. The Vril had been told that this would enable them to travel faster than the speed of light. They had conveyed specific details on how to achieve this. So specific, in fact, that a test flight was conducted. The Vril were allowed to use Vril 7, a large capacity disc, 45 meters in diameter that had just been built and tested. According to reports, the first test flight in the Dimension Channel took place in the winter of 1944 with the craft tightly tethered. In this way, the Vril engine could be used as a sort of stargate. It was a sobering experience, just short of disaster. The Vril 7 returned after the flight looking as if it had been flying for 100 years. The outer skin was damaged in several places. For sure, these problems would have to be addressed before the real trip to Aldebaran was made or the passengers would not survive. Vril 7 at the Brandenburg Testing Grounds. The woman in the foreground is the Vril Gesellschaft medium Sigrun, who has been authenticated in other World War II photos standing in front of FW-190 fighters. She not only supervised the construction of Vril 7 but she was also its pilot. Vril's medium Sigrun made frequent trips to the facility to oversee construction and testing of the Vril 7. In 1944, a group of engineers approached her with a request. They wanted to know if the Vril Treblork engine could be adapted to one of their projects, the Erido E.555 strategic bomber. They were abruptly told no and returned to their conventional designs. Sigrun was actually insulted because the entire purpose of the Vril discs was aimed at peaceful space flight. In early March of 1945, the Thule Society received a letter, signed by Maria Ortig, making reference to the trip to Aldebaran. It seems some of the Vril group had already made the trip and had decided to stay. The letter ends with, "Man blipped higher, no one has remained here." But did they really go to another planet? Many people now believe that Aldebaran was a red herring. The real destination was the utopia that was being established in the Antarctic, New Swabyland. This was the raison d'etre for the racial purity and breeding programs. This is where the 100-plus submarines that Allies counted missing were sent, along with countless cargo ships. During the occupation of Germany, at the beginning of 1945, Americans discovered photographs of the Hanabutu and the Vril I crafts as well as of the Andromeda device, the 300-foot cigar-shaped craft, in the secret archives of the SS. But their most precious find were two prominent scientists, Victor Schaberger and Wernher von Braun, who were ushered into the U.S. under the now unclassified Project Paperclip. It's no wonder that a certain American air and space developer is reported to have confessed before he died, "If the public ever learns that we have had this technology all these years, they will never forgive us for keeping it secret." Conspiracy theorists often attempt to show that the same Thule and Vril designs appear in contemporary UFO photographs. They say this proves the Nazis escaped with the craft before the war's end and explains why we see UFO craft so often. I like to think there is a group of humans, somewhere, who have worked so diligently to improve their genetics, creating a superior and more healthy body and mind. Looking at our world today, it seems a goal beyond reach. It is said that the Vril energy can repair a body's DNA, allowing one to revert to the healthiest state of youth. The medium Sigrun was supposedly 140 years old and never aged. Lots of things are possible when you can manipulate time. So I hope you liked this video. Please share our videos on Facebook with your friends. Don't forget to do like, subscribe and comments on our video. Thanks for watching.